Well, good morning. Great to be in the house of the Lord this morning. We're going to be in chapter 23 of Joshua this morning, so if you want to turn your Bibles there, that'd be great. If you need a Bible, these fellows would be happy to give you one this morning as well. Got up this morning, getting ready for church, cut myself shaving. Has that ever happened to you guys? It is so obnoxious, it really is. I've had people recommend razor blades to me after the fact. I've just been using my dad's Bowie knife. It seems, you know, heat that up real good in the fire in the morning and it works great. I don't know. Just as a word of announcement for you, there is no men's fraternity tomorrow night. We will not be meeting, but we will be meeting a week from tomorrow, and we are going to have one of our special dinners with, the turkey and the roast beef and all that kind of stuff and pie and all that good stuff. And I've been asked about my upcoming trip that I have in June to teach in China, and so I'll be talking about that trip and what all is going on with that and giving some information about that. So it should be a good time. We'll have a word of prayer as well. So if you would like to attend that, the cost is $10. That covers the price for the food. And there is a sign-up sheet in the foyer on your way out today. If you'd sign up, that'd be awesome. Also, this is an exciting week. I'm just really fired up because on Friday night, we have our spring Bible conference, and I'm excited about it. Dr. Bookman taught me Life of Christ back in 1975, if you want to put dates together, and he's been following the Lord. He's been over there, as Steve mentioned, dozens of times, and it's just when he teaches about the life of Christ, it just comes alive. Because you know that he has been there, he can talk about certain roads, he can talk about towns, and he's been there, he's so enmeshed in it that it's just amazing. The information you will get will blow your mind, and that is quite a statement, I understand. There were things that I never saw in Scripture, there were things that I've read through dozens and hundreds of times, never put two and two together, and that's what he does. So he brings it all together, it will be phenomenal. So if you can come Friday night, you can't come Saturday, by all means come Friday night. If you can come Saturday and not Friday night, show up on the Saturday whenever you can make it. It will bless your heart, I will guarantee that. So just to encourage you this week, be looking forward to Friday night, and it should just be awesome. How many of you plan to attend part of it, at least part of it? Okay, a good number of you do, and I hope your plans will change and the rest of you will be able to make it, and we'll be able to be together on Friday night. So looking forward to it. It will bless you. We are in Joshua chapter 23 this morning, where the Bible says, "Now it came about after many days, when the Lord had given rest to Israel from all their enemies on every side, and Joshua was old and advanced in years, that Joshua called for all Israel, for their elders and for their heads and judges and the officers, and said to them, 'I am old, advanced in years, and you have seen all that the Lord your God has done.'" Well, this passage of Scripture, I believe, will definitely bless us as we have the opportunity to study it. It seems like Joshua has this phenomenal opportunity. In Joshua's life, he has seen many, many things. Going all the way back to the days of Moses, he was there when the spies went out into the land. He was able to participate in that. He comes back with reports that are grand, and he is expecting God to do great and mighty things. He is a man who has been following the Lord for a very, very long time. And as God had called him out on this earlier in the book of Joshua, Joshua, you are old, and it is getting towards the end. Now, have you ever imagined what your end of your life would be like? You know, you've seen those movies, you know, where the guy's laying in bed and he's ready to expire, and he brings the family together. And he says some things of tremendous value, and wisdom just pours from his mind and heart. And it impacts his family, and they go on and live great lives. You know that. Well, you know, I don't know how we're all going to find the end, and but that would be pretty cool, wouldn't it? I mean, you know, Karen, get the kids, bring the grandkids in, And then you got to pray for some wisdom because you got to say something smart, right? Well, Joshua is just overflowing with some tremendous wisdom. And this morning, what we're going to do is we're just going to glean from the things that he wants to share. And I trust this morning it'll be a blessing to each one of us. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you, Father, for the testimony of this great man, a man of tremendous faith, who's an example to all of us, Lord, for his commitment to obey you. Lord, you challenged him right back in the first book or first chapter of this book. You called upon him to be courageous and faithful, to not let the book of the law depart out of his mouth. And truly, he has been true to this. And so we listen to his words this morning, and we take them to heart. Help them, Father, to impact us in a most profound and relevant way. And I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Well, Joshua begins there, and he kind of picks this up in verse 3 when he says, "And you have seen all that the Lord your God has done to all these nations because of you. For the Lord your God is he who has been fighting for you." One of the things that we see as we look at this passage in chapter 23, that God is good all the time. And there's a look back here that begins with the faithfulness of God. Joshua is going to recall the faithfulness of Almighty Jehovah. And it's so important for the people to recognize that God has indeed been faithful to his word. As we read the Bible and as we ingest the scriptures, how vital it truly is for us to understand that God is a God of his word. Amen? If God wasn't a God of his word, would we really be dedicated to studying what he has revealed about himself? Well, the answer would be simply no. And so what Joshua wants to do is he wants to bring to remembrance the phenomenal things that God has done. He calls them to remember the fact that he was faithful. Think about this as you think about the people of Israel and their walk with God. God had called them out of Egypt and promised them a new life in a new land. It was fully occupied by the enemy. It was going to be an enormous, enormous challenge to get to the point where they can actually go in and dwell in the land. As they come up the eastern side of the Jordan River, there were a lot of questions, no doubt. As they start to encounter giants, they're probably wondering to themselves, is this really going to turn out well? Is God going to do exactly what he says he will do? And this is where Joshua picks up on this, and he underscores the reality that yes, to a point, to the exact point of every single word that God had spoken to the people of Israel, he was faithful to do all the things that he said he would do. Our faithful God is to be commended for this. And Joshua points out the fact that it's the Lord your God who's been fighting for you in verse 3. And he goes on to say, "See, I have apportioned to you these nations which remain." And now he tells us about what God is still going to do. He says, "I am going to basically fight these battles." In verse 5, "The Lord your God, he will thrust them out from before you. He'll drive them from before you and you will possess their land." Picture this. Most of the land has been delivered into the hands of the Israelites. There are small pockets that are well defined here in Scripture where there is some resistance. There are some of the Philistine cities that are still not conquered. There are remnants in the hill countries here and there, but they're always specifically mentioned. And now God's plan is for these tribes to go into their inherited land and cast out these Canaanites that are still there in the land. It shouldn't be that hard. In fact, verse 5 tells us that it is God who will continue his work in driving these peoples out of the land. God has not stepped back and said, "I will not do this for you. I'm going to finish the job." But it would require the faith of each and every one of the tribes to follow the Lord as completely as Joshua has done that on a national level. And so they need to come to the Lord and follow the Lord as well. And God says, I'm going to drive these people out. I'll thrust them out of the land. It's a great way of speaking. I'm going to do this, and there's no question that the victory will be won. God is good all the time. And there's a look back on his faithfulness. Now notice there in verse 9, if you would. We're just going to skip down to verse 9. For he says, the Lord has driven. And Joshua now looks back again. He says, the Lord has driven out great and strong nations from before you. And as for you, no man has stood before you to this day. One of your men puts to flight 1,000. For the Lord your God is he who fights for you, just as he promised you. Wow. This is really amazing. That is a reference there when he talks about people being put to flight. It kind of goes back to Deuteronomy chapter 32, where it says, how could one man chase 1,000 or two, put 10,000 to flight, unless their rock had sold them, unless the Lord had given them up? You see, God was fighting their battles. Isn't that wonderful? I guess they'd say the Marines, one Marine can take care of how many guys? 50, is it? Is that what it is? Yeah, one Marine, 50 guys. That's an awesome ratio. But it doesn't compare to what God can do. No offense to the Marines. God says, one of you can put to flight 1,000 because I am all powerful. And look, Joshua says at what God has done. This is our God. This is amazing how faithful he has been. He told you that this would be the condition when you went into the promised land. I will drive them out. And Joshua, on his deathbed, reminisces about the faithful, awesome power of God. Without a doubt, the people are challenged as they hear, indeed, God is good. He is faithful. But if you look at verse 26, you'll see that man is not good all the time. That faithfulness is a present need in the life of man. I notice here in verse 6, it says, as Joshua would call upon the people, he says, be very firm then to keep and do all that is written in the book of the law of Moses, so that you might not turn aside from it to the right hand or to the left, so that you will not associate with these nations, these which remain among you, or mention the name of their gods, or make anyone swear by them, or serve them, or bow down to them. But you, he says, are to cling to the Lord your God, as you have done to this day. The Israelites were to keep themselves uncontaminated from the other nations. They lived among the world. There were these nations who were very pagan. We've talked about their sin. We've talked about their wickedness to length. But the Israelites were to guard themselves and keep them from the association with these people. In fact, that is the reason why God said, I want these people to be driven out of the land so that you won't associate with them. Problem was that this was one of the big problems for the people of Israel. As you think it through, you can think of examples, no doubt. It is the dominant problem in the book of Judges, where the people of Israel keep going back and delving into the pagan customs of the day. And they grab a hold of those pagan customs and they step away from Almighty God. This is what would break the heart of God over Solomon. Great man, great wise man. Solomon would grab onto the world. He had hundreds of wives, as you know, and we find that the problem with Solomon was that he really wasn't as sold out to God as he needed to be. Later on, the northern kingdom, Israel, as Israel and Judah were divided, Israel is carted off into exile, and not long after that, Judah follows. This reasoning behind all of this comes down to one thing. Notice with me there the verse that I read in verse 8, where he says, but you are to cling to the Lord your God. The word translated some places, hold fast or to cling tightly. It's a fascinating word. It has actually some deep theological meaning to it. Over in Isaiah chapter 41 in verse 7, the root of it there is used as well. And it's used for the process of soldering. Does everybody know what soldering is? All right, let's say you've got a wire connection, and you've got two of these wires, and you need to put the wires together. There's a lot of different ways we can put wires together. Now, maybe you're working on your boat, or maybe you're working on this new sound system that you've gotten, and you're trying to put these wires together. You can take those wires and you can just simply twist them together. And how long is that going to last? Well, until somebody tugs on one of the ends, and then they're just going to come apart. So you say to yourself, I think I'm going to do this better. I'm going to wrap it up after I twist them together with some electrical tape. And that'll hold it a little bit better. But you say, well, that's not good enough for me. I'm going to put a wire nut on there. And so you put them together, you tie it up, and then you get that wire nut, you put that wire, plastic wire nut on there with the little metal thing, and you say, now that's good. And your wife looks over and she says, listen, you didn't do it right. And she puts some electrical tape around it. Now you've really got it, but you really don't have it because it can still come apart. And so what you want to do is you want to get that soldering iron out, and you want to get that solder, and you want to heat up those wires. And so as they're wrapped around each other, you heat those wires up, and then you touch the solder to it, and the solder goes in, and it merges with the wires, and it makes it one piece. Now, this analogy is how God describes the relationship of his people to him. Isn't that interesting? God says, I want you to be soldered to me. I want you to be so close to me that there's no pulling us apart. You see, the world's going to get in there and the world's going to try to pull you apart. That's why just wrapping the wires up is not going to work. That's why just a little electrical tape's not going to work. That's why even a wire nut probably won't work. What you really want to do is you want to solder it together, God says. I want you to cling to me. The people of Israel needed to cling to their God. This is what they're called upon to do. Keeping the law is important. Observing the ordinances are important. But it all comes under the umbrella. And the umbrella itself is loving God. Think of Deuteronomy chapter 6. Where we read that it is the duty of the Israelites to love God, love him with all their soul and their strength and their might. Jesus would reiterate this as one of the two great commandments, love the Lord thy God with all your heart and soul and strength. You see, this is what really matters, and everything else, all those exhortations and entanglements and everything else are not going to enter into your heart and life if you supremely love God as he has called you to love him. The problem is that you and I oftentimes fail to love God enough. And that's why the world is so appealing to us. We get pulled aside to the world because the reality is God is not what he needs to be in our life. The problem for Solomon wasn't that he just had an attraction to these women and he wanted to build an empire for himself. The problem with Solomon is he didn't love God as supremely as he needed to. He wasn't clinging to God. He wasn't soldered to the heart of God. And you and I are called upon as followers of Jesus Christ today to follow him with the same passion. Now, I understand when you look at Joshua, you can't bring it 100% over to 2017 for us today. When you look at Joshua, Joshua is a theocracy. It's different. We have an entire nation, the people of Israel. And some of the people were people of faith, but not all of them certainly were people of faith. But they were all Israelites. And so they would be blessed or cursed basically on their decisions that they made as a people. And so it's important to note for us today, there are differences. But one of these principles that carries over is the principle of a heart that is fixated on Christ, where Christ is who we love the most. The world wants to pry its way into our life. The world wants to do all that it can. And because you and I are typically at times not faithful to God, we need to be reminded as well that what God has called us to is to love him. You say, how could the Israelites not love God? Look at all the things that the Lord has done for them. He has chased out all of these giants. He has defeated all of these groups. He's done miracle after miracle after miracle for them. Wouldn't you suppose that it would be second nature to these people to love God supremely? And yet that's not what happens. They get pulled away. And because of that, they start to cling to their own gods. I want you to see with me verses 14 and 15, because we know that man is not faithful all the time. And we have to be reminded for the purpose and the direction of Joshua's farewell address. Joshua begins to speak this here in verse 14. He says, "Now behold, today I'm going the way of all the earth, and you know in your hearts and in your souls that not one word of all the good words which the Lord your God spoke concerning you has failed. All have been fulfilled for you. Not one of them has failed." God is absolutely faithful. Now, would you agree with me this morning that God is faithful in his promises? People of Israel are reminded that God is faithful. That this was the whole reason behind Joshua's explanation and his praise for God. But what Joshua is going to remind us of is found there in verse 15. "It shall come about that just as all the good words which the Lord your God spoke to you have come upon you, so the Lord will bring upon you all the threats until he has destroyed you from off this good land when the Lord your God has given you," which the Lord his God has given you. Stop and think about that. God, who is faithful in promising all of those good things, we can absolutely say, as the people of Israel, if go back in time and stand there, and you're listening to Joshua, and you're saying, "Yes, God has been faithful in all the things that he's promised." And Joshua points out the reality that God is as well faithful in the threats that he's made. You see, you don't have the word of God without having faithfulness. So when God comes and he warns the people of Israel that if you cling to the things of this world, there's going to be a penalty, we're reminded that he really means it. I go back up there to verse 11, and it says, "So take diligent heed to yourselves to love the Lord your God. For if you ever go back and cling," and he uses that almost a wordplay there, because he uses the same word as he used above there for cling, "if you solder yourself to the rest of these nations, these which remain among you, and intermarry with them so that you associate with them and they with you, know with certainty that the Lord your God will not continue to drive out these nations from before you, but they will be a snare and a trap to you, a whip on your sides and thorns in your eyes until you perish from off this good land which the Lord your God has given you." There is no guarantee that you will receive the blessings of God if you abandon him and you cling to this world. Now, they were to love him and understand the reasoning for it. I stop and I think about some of the anger of the Lord that would burn against the people of Israel. It says that when, verse 16, "when you transgress the covenant of the Lord your God, which he commands you, and you go and serve other gods and bow down to them, then the anger of the Lord will burn against you, and you will perish quickly from off the good land which he's given to you." Well, over in the book of Judges, we have the anger of the Lord burning against Israel, so he sells them into the hands of Cushan-Rishathaim, king of Aram. If you take your Bibles and just flip with me over a couple of pages, you'll come to Judges chapter 2. Even though Joshua is compelled to make this farewell address to the people of Israel and really encourage them to do the right thing, even though he's been very forceful with it and he's trying to make his point, by the time you come to Judges 2:11, it says the sons of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals. And they forsook the Lord, the God of their fathers, who had brought them up out of the land of Egypt, and followed other gods from among them and bowed themselves down to them. Thus they provoked the anger of the Lord, and so they forsook the Lord and served Baal and the Asheroth. And the anger of the Lord burned against Israel, and he gave them into the hands of plunderers who plundered them, and he sold them into the hands of their enemies around them, so that they could no longer stand before their enemies. Wherever they went, the hand of the Lord was against them for evil. As the Lord had spoken and as the Lord had sworn to them, so they were severely distressed. See, the difficulty here is one that's easy to see. Because there's a pattern that will take place. Here we are. Joshua just gets through exclaiming the promises of God are faithful. And even the threats of Almighty God. You need to be wary of those things, because if you transgress, then God will be true to his word. Notice here the pattern of the people of Israel during the time of the judges. They would sin against God. They would commit that sin and walk away. That's what we just got through reading. They began to serve the Baals and horrible, horrible pagan deities and all that's associated with that. And as they did that, the Lord would oppress them. They would come under the judgment of various kings and leaders. And over time, when it got so distressful, the people of Israel would call out for a deliverer. I think of Gideon as he's there on the threshing floor. The Midianites were oppressing the people of Israel. They couldn't even bring their grain in, and they call out for God. And God hears their cry, and he brings a judge who will deliver the people of Israel. And they are delivered for a period of time. And then the cycle would start all over again. And God would have to bring oppressors again. The people would be distressed, and they would call out for help. God is over them, and he's told them exactly why these things are going to take place. And the cycle repeats over and over and over again. Now, what I find is fascinating here, if you look with me at Judges chapter 2, God says, I will also no longer drive out before them any of the nations which Joshua left when he died. And here's the purpose for this. In order to test Israel by them, whether they will keep the way of the Lord to walk in it as their fathers did or not. So God allowed, the Lord allowed those nations to remain, not driving them out quickly, and he did not give them into the hand of Joshua. Here's what's so fascinating. All of these little pockets God could have removed, but he didn't choose to do that. Instead, he leaves these little pockets. He tells the people of Israel, I will drive these out like I drove the others out. But these, God says here, are left so as to be a test for the people of Israel. Now, when you come to a verse of scripture like these, or a couple verses like this, our antennas should go up. Because what God is doing is he is unveiling his motivation behind what's happening. Are you with me on that? I mean, so you don't know oftentimes what the mindset of God is for different things that happen. But here you glimpse into the mind of God. And so there's a reason for this. Now, I'm also aware of the fact that God uses evil for good. That's what Joseph would say. All things work together for good, Paul says in Romans, to those who love God and are called according to his purpose. But understand that God had a motivation. Here are these remnants. God says, I didn't drive them out quickly. I didn't deliver them into the hand of Joshua. Joshua was a faithful man. If God had delivered them into the hands of Joshua, guess what would have happened? Joshua would have driven them out. If anything we know about Joshua, we know his consistent testimony of obedience. And they would have been driven out. And remember, it wasn't up to them, it was up to God. All God wants to hear is, I'll do it. And because they did not cling to the Lord, but clung to the world, God didn't drive them out. And so they remained there as a test. Think this through. At the end of any one of these cycles, things could have ended for good. But the people of Israel in the book of Judges keep doing that which is right in their own eyes and repeating the cycle. Now, I got thinking this week. It's never that good when I think. But I sat down and I was thinking about something that might be relative to this. And I understand again today that we do not live in the time that Joshua is written in, and our relationship with God, thankfully, is different today. We're under a new covenant. But I thought about how powerful God is. God could have driven out these remnants, but he leaves them there as a test. Have you ever run across someone who believes in the doctrine of sinless perfection or holiness, the holiness movement? They might believe that once you place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, your sin nature is gone completely, and you don't sin anymore. Now, I've been around a couple of those guys, and they're not believable. They might think their sin nature's gone, but if you hang around with somebody long enough, you find out, I don't care who they are, you find out they have a sin nature, because we all still have our sin nature. But have you ever asked yourself the question, I wonder, Lord, why you didn't just take away that sin nature? I wish the whole doctrine of sinless perfection was true. Wouldn't it be great if I was standing up here this morning preaching a doctrine that was supported in the scriptures to say that once you put your faith in Jesus Christ and in him alone and you're saved, you are a new creature and you'll never sin again. Wouldn't that be great? Instead, we get Romans chapter 7 where Paul says, the things that I want to do, I don't do, and the things I don't want to do, I do. And so you and I find ourselves in conflict with the sin nature. And I got thinking about that. And I thought, if God wanted to take away my sin nature, he could have. But it wasn't part of the design. It wasn't part of the plan. But my sin nature, while I absolutely detest it, it is the most hated thing in my life. And when I die, and I get resurrected someday, and it's still there, see ya. Won't that be a happy day for all of us? The sin nature is no longer part of the equation. But up until that time, the sin nature remains. But I think if God could use those wicked, wicked people as a test to bring about glory to himself through obedience by his people, the Israelites, so you and I today can bring glory to God by not following the desires of our sin nature. In fact, every time there is a crossroads, and there's probably been a crossroad for every one of the children of God who are in this building right now, there's already been a crossroad today. But at every one of those crossroads, if we will choose to obey Christ and not follow our sin nature, we'll bring glory to him. I still hate my sin nature. But I actually see something that can be positive that can come out of it. People of Israel called upon to cling to God, to love him supremely and let that drive everything else in their life. And the same thing is true for you and me. If we will love God supremely and let that drive everything else in our life, the things of this world will not be so alluring. The things of this life will not be so compelling to follow. My friends, we need to be inseparably linked to the Savior and follow him with the utmost devotion so that this world fails to appeal. So that Jesus is the most sought after person of my life. And walking with him matters more than the things of this world. If the people of Israel had done that, how different it would have been. And if the people of God today will do that, how different things can be today as well. Would you bow your heads for just a moment as we have the opportunity this morning to pray together? You may be here this morning and you may be here for the first time and you've never heard about what Jesus Christ has done for you on the cross. But understand that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sin. And his sacrifice on the cross is sufficient to wash away your sin today if you will call upon him. Maybe you're here this morning and you're not sure about where you're going to spend your eternity. There are questions in your heart and mind. You have some uncertainty. Perhaps you're clinging to your good works. Maybe you're thinking that your religion or the things that you have done, maybe you're comparing yourself to others, whatever it may be that's going on in your life, but it's left you insecure. You don't have that confidence that if you died today, you'd spend eternity with Christ in heaven. And if that's real in your life, then the Bible calls upon you to place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ and know for certain that you have eternal life. While it's true that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, that means every single one of us has a sin nature. The Bible tells us that God commended his love toward us and that while we were still sinning, Christ died for us. And whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Have you made that decision in your life, a personal decision, to place your faith in Christ and him alone? If you will call upon his name today, he's faithful and just to forgive you your sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. But if you cling to something other than Jesus Christ, not only will you not have assurance of salvation, but you will spend an eternity away from God in a place that's prepared for the devil and the fallen angels. I trust that today you'll not leave here without assurance that you're a follower of Jesus Christ. And if you happen to be a follower of Jesus Christ, may you and I decide this week to love Christ as supremely as he deserves. That he would have our hearts and our minds, that we would follow him without wavering. The things of this world would grow, as the hymn says, strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Would you stand with me as we pray? Our Father God, we thank you and praise you for the work of Jesus on the cross. May our faith be true. May we truly come to embrace the Savior and know that we are on our way to heaven because of our faith in Christ and what he has done. Help us, Father, as followers of Jesus, to love you more than the world, to cling to you and show our faithfulness to you, Lord, by pursuing you each and every day. May we live this week, Lord, in such a way as to demonstrate our supreme love for you. The world might see and know that there's something different in our hearts. I pray this all in Christ's wonderful name. Amen. God bless you. Hope to see you Friday.